Well, good evening, everyone. I'm Stacy McClendon. I'm one of the teachers at Common Ground Meditation Center, and it makes me happy to be here on a Friday evening to lean into a shower of love and kindness. I can't remember who it is. The Dharma teacher says the purpose of meditation is to know the mind, train the mind, free the mind. Right? So we sit down in this quiet stillness to learn the habits of the mind, what motivates us, what hooks us. The nature of our reactions, not necessarily trying to change, but just know. And this acknowledging even that undermines the momentum of a conditioned pattern of the mind. And in order to free the mind from these conditioned patterns and fixed views, the training of the mind, right? So it's what we're doing when we sit down on the cushion, not simply inviting magical transformation, right? But actually taking responsibility for the disposition of the mind, what we think, how we respond to what we think, our actions, our words, what we're actually setting in motion in the world, in our relationships, and being willing to explore all aspects of the self, right? Our shadow side, for ourselves, and being willing to open to the same challenges, difficulties, shortcomings, imperfections in other people. Meeting that with care, with this positive, kind regard, with compassion. And this training is also involves setting intentions. So again, not sitting down for a magical transformation, but acknowledging our effort that's required. Engage in actions. We are choosing actions that liberate the heart, liberate the mind from greed, hatred, delusion. And that's what the Buddha taught of these divine abodes, the Brahma Viharas. He is said to have taught that a wise person always dwells in one or more of these states. Loving kindness, metta, compassion, karuna. Always residing in one of these places, that dwelling, divine abode, like home. And I think of home, I often think of, you know, physical space where we reside, and that is, that can be, you know, we can think of the body in that way. You know, a place where we are in harmony with our surroundings. We can be at ease, even when it's unpleasant. We're not necessarily pulled about, hooked, dragged, maybe. Even in sports, as baseball, as a home base, or as kids, when we're making up our games outside, one of the strategies or important setups was, okay, where's home? Because if you make it to home, you're safe. Right? You can't be tagged, can't be tackled. Think of home as a refuge. We sought that, understood that even in our youth. And these Brahma Viharas are just that. Place where we can be safe, feel protected, on familiar ground even, relaxed and comfortable. And our conditioning, our social conditioning is such that we maybe forget about this place of refuge. And maybe where we become so accustomed to living at a quickened pace and being agitated or disappointed or frustrated that becomes our default, our resting place. And then we come together in Sangha, listen to the teachings and study, practice together, and we're reminded that this joy, this freedom, is not dependent on external conditions. We can be kind and compassionate and delight in another's joy, even if they're delighting in something that we don't necessarily like or agree with. What we're transforming is our own heart, our own mind. And I remember early in my own practice, going on metta retreat and hearing the phrases and feeling like, oh, this just wasn't landing. It didn't feel genuine. Half the time I didn't understand what difference it would make. One person or a bunch of people sitting in a room wishing well to people. And the other half of the time I was like, oh, I'm the only one that's not filled with this loving kindness. Didn't necessarily feel realistic. And part of the challenge for me, I think, was that I was relating to the metta phrases as just words. And it's not a state of mind that we're cultivating. It's a heart quality. They're not just words. And I also didn't understand the tiers of people, right? And we actually go through the different categories of people to help us begin to unpack where we've put up our own roadblocks and barriers to being kind, expressing compassion, meeting joy with joy, or just seeing things the way they are. So our practice is to connect with the words with meaning. How does it feel in the body? What is the resonance? So after each phrase, and we'll use the traditional phrases this evening. Maybe happy and safe, protected, healthy and strong. And take pause. After offering the phrases, to check in. How does that resonate in the body? How does that feel to make this offering? And I want to acknowledge that not all of us grew up in a place where these intentions or these qualities were nurtured or acknowledged even. And we have maybe have developed some unskillful ways of protecting ourselves. In many households, unfortunately, where it wasn't safe to be authentic, tender, vulnerable. So this is a relearning, the way to be in relationship with one another. And so very important, because in the absence of training the mind in this way, we begin to develop these categories of who's deserving of our loving kindness or our compassion, what behaviors are acceptable and not. And perhaps we're just indifferent to those people, places, things, ways of being that don't align with our beliefs. So we'll practice together. Settle in, feel comfortable and relaxed posture, and still upright and alert, spine straight. You can close the eyes and have a gentle downward gaze. Allowing the nervous system to settle. The breath settling into its own natural rhythm. Feeling the weight of the body sitting. And we can begin this offering to ourselves. May I be happy and peaceful. Checking in with the body, feeling where there might be resistance. Maybe happy and peaceful. May I be safe and protected. harm, danger. May I be healthy and strong. If it feels natural to move, to extend these wishes to someone in our life, it's an easy person that comes to mind. We don't have to effort to identify someone. It's open to see who arises and isn't resistance or conflict. It could be a pet, an old friend. May you be happy and peaceful. May you be safe and protected from harm and danger. May you be healthy and strong. You can stay with that person if that feels useful. You can move on to offering these wishes to a benefactor, to a teacher, or mentor. Again, just allowing an image or person to come to mind, not over efforting to think of someone. May you be happy and peaceful. May you be safe and protected from harm and danger. May you be healthy and strong. Again, we'll move on to the next category of people. If it feels useful to stay with yourself, easy person or benefactor, please stay. Next category, people. People are a person that's dear to us. Again, we don't have to call up anyone in particular. See who arises in the heart. Think of someone who's dear to you and care for. Have trust and feel close to. Maybe it's a family member or a friend. Could be a colleague. Or a pet. May you be happy and peaceful. Feeling in the body. Sensations of offering these well wishes. May you be safe and protected from harm and danger. May you be healthy and strong. Broadening our intention for well-being and happiness and safety. Broadening these wishes out. We move next to a neutral person in our life. Perhaps it's a clerk at the gas station we visit, or the grocery store, the bookstore. Perhaps it's a customer service agent on the other end of the telephone. Someone we don't know, we don't know well. Not whom we've encountered in our lives, in our day. Wishing them well. May you too be happy and peaceful. May you be safe and protected from harm and danger. May you be healthy and strong. Relaxing into the heart's capacity to be full of kindness and care. Without resistance, and allowing that to move and be offered, even those who don't know well. Checking in with the body. Where is the sensation to ease? Are there smoothing tension? Simply noting, like this now, without judgment. And if you're ready, we'll move on to a difficult person. Not the most difficult person in your life. Maybe someone you had an exchange with today that was tense. Some lingering difference. Noticing what changes in the body when this person comes up in the heart and the mind. May you too be happy and peaceful. May you be safe and protected from harm and from danger. May you be healthy and strong. Not forcing these well wishes, but opening the heart and allowing what's naturally there to move, expressed, directed toward this difficult person and difficult group of people. May you be happy and peaceful. May you be safe and protected. May you be healthy and strong. And just as the sun shines on all of us, plants and trees, and grass and flowers and animals without exception, so too is the heart's capacity to radiate out loving kindness, passion, sympathetic joy, equanimity to all beings, without exception. May all beings be happy and peaceful. May all beings be safe and protected from harm and danger. May all beings be healthy and strong. May all beings be happy and peaceful. May we all be safe and protected from harm and danger. May we all be healthy and strong. Feeling the body, mind, heart's resistance. waiting, perhaps. We need to have categories, relaxing. As we wish the same peace and happiness for all beings. As near and far away, easy and difficult. As known to us and as yet to be known. May all beings be healthy and strong and safe and protected. Take a minute to stretch your legs, move your body a little, take a sip of tea or water. These practices, these states of mind, states of heart are really incompatible with a hating state of mind, wishing someone peace and happiness and health, strength, safety, protection. Or checking in with your body, moving from the self to an easy, lovable person, all the way through neutral or benefactor, benefactor, dear one, neutral person. Did you notice changes in your body? Sensations, resistance, anything that surprised you? Did you feel the same generous offering all the way through? Amazing. We can be so soft in 1 minute. And then, like you said, and the next is pain from the constriction of wanting to hold on to this love. Rest and move. These divisions, are we actually create them in our mind. We actually, when we offer loving kindness, compassion to all beings, which sometimes we want to just jump to that, just cover everyone, right? But it really is going through these different categories, different layers that really represent the relationships that we have in our life, right? People that are sort of close to us or sometimes difficult and sometimes our dear one and difficult person could be the same person, just give it different day. Right? And noticing the constriction, the tightness that comes with withholding. It's actually a withholding of care and love. It's not that it's not there, flowing, right? Instead, what we're holding center, oftentimes, is the narrative, this past experience that we've had, this hurt that has arisen. And we put them in the category of not deserving, right? Not deserving of our full love. I don't know about you, but I often have this idea that we have to agree, or that if we disagree, that the tension is natural and warranted, or that there should be distance if we disagree, or and this ride that is relationship, it's all of those things. Oftentimes the easy person who's lovable and kind, and then difficult. I like to remember that it is probable that I too am someone's difficult person. Like, can they still send me these wishes for loving kindness, maybe happy, even though I'm their difficult person today? I mean, we have lots of moments, right? Every minute, every waking moment is an opportunity to try again. And relationships are complicated. I think I got this quote out of David Rico, I believe is his name, R-I-C-O-H-C-H-O. He wrote How to Be an Adult in Relationships. So when my partner and I are, and this is many years old, are in a place and, you know, we're both doing the same old thing. This actually hasn't happened in a long while. We're both doing the same old thing. I would go to this book. And one of the quotes that really stuck with me is he's describing sort of love. And I've co-opted it when I'm talking about loving kindness, because it's the same sentiment. It's not a romantic love, this loving kindness. But he describes it as a kindly support of your path, no matter how unusual, of your feelings, no matter how disturbing, of your deficiency, no matter how irritating. And I just love that. If we could just hold that and show up for one another, kind regard. It's not a pass, right? You don't get to be mean and rude, right? But remembering that we all stumble on this path and are still deserving of respect, kindness, experience. Is it an expression? Are you thinking metta? So you're making a distinction between mind and heart. In some ways, it's all one vessel, right? That's heart, right? Mind, body. It's where we are giving the most attention to. We distinguish the mind because we think so much, right?
Right.
We're thinking, planning, remembering, ruminating. And we can set an intention. That certainly happens in the mind. Set the intention to act from this place of kindness, to speak from this place of kindness. And this well wish, it certainly, you know, we formulate that idea, like, may you be happy. That's formulated in the mind. So I wonder what that experience is for you. Is all of that happening in your mind? And you perhaps, you know, I said in jest in the beginning, you know, we sit down, it's not that we're waiting for metta to rain over us and we're magically transformed, but I wonder if you have some preconceived idea of what this practice would be, and that you are practicing metta, but you're setting some standard, I wonder. I think many of us have that experience in meditation. This isn't going right. This isn't going well. Oh, I'm thinking again, or I'm thinking about the wrong thing, or thinking about the bad thing, or having negative thoughts. Like, it is what the mind does. And we have made it this far in life without training the mind in this way. And so in that sense, it kind of is the old dog that we were trying to teach a new trick, right? It keeps going back. Like, this is what I do. And it's meeting even that habit with the softness. Like, oh, there you go again. That's okay. We're going to come back here and try loving kindness. Oh, there you go again. Try again. I'm going to stay right here with you. Right here. Come back. And maybe without, and you can experiment with this, that staying with yourself, or the easy person without moving through, because that imposes, like, oh, I have to get to the next level. I have to graduate, right? Graduate to the next level. And really taking the liberty to stay, like, no, I need to be right here. And you know that. You will know that. If it feels like pressure, efforting to move on. Yeah, there are invitations all over the place for us to arrive with this open heart. And that's really what the metta practice calls us to do, is to see where our heart is closed. Ultimately, the practice is being metta, where there aren't categories or groups of people that we're directing it to, that we are able to meet all experience, all people, with this softness, with this kindness. No need to be mean or wish harm or ill will upon another. That we're not closing our hearts to anyone, even though they may have behaved unskillfully. And perhaps we know someone who has said something perhaps inappropriate or mean, or had some inappropriate or illegal even behavior. And how did we respond? When it's someone that we know, that someone close to us, perhaps our easy person to love, or our benefactor, and it sometimes can make it easier for us to find our way to understanding how they arrived there. We remember, oh yeah, they're not perfect. Oh yeah, they've had perhaps trauma in their life. And somehow, or sometimes, we're crestfallen because we've put this person that's dear to us on a pedestal. And I can't believe that my Dharma teacher would say something unskillful or so unwise. And we remember, oh yeah, they're a human being too, right? With their own lived experience. And then we can see, even as we look out at those other groups of people, how easy it is, or how quick we've been, or how much we haven't even questioned our judgment about people who do those sort of things. Right. And again, this practice is not about an unilateral endorsement of any sort of illicit behavior. We have the person, and we have choices. Choices that are made, our actions, our words. And certainly we've stepped in it from time to time and said the thing that we wish we wouldn't have said or did the thing that maybe we knew we shouldn't have done. Right? And can we recall, perhaps it was a friend or a family member that stood with us, not as an endorsement, but as a caring human being who saw us fully. And was there to help us get up and in this moment begin again. And that is the feeling to remember and let wash over us, what that felt like, what that feels like when someone sits with us, stands with us, not our brightest day, and how that action in and of itself allows us to show up more fully. Right? It actually inspires us to be our better selves. And all of our hearts, each of our hearts, we have that capacity. As we, especially as practitioners, as we understand or bring our attention to not only the external conditions, but our own mind state that gives rise to stress or distress, right? That holding of negative view, negative narrative. And certainly, I have a friend, certainly I will not forget that they caused harm. And there's there can be kindness and care in accountability. I've been a bit taken aback over the last year and responses to Derek Chauvin, a readiness to spew hate is intended or touted to be a demonstration of allegiance to justice. And it's just so confusing. It's so confused, I think. It's not confusing. It is confused. Because we know that hatred does not dissolve hatred. I think in order to hate, one has to have known that experience directly. And so this practice, this metta, it's like a balm on the heart that's been broken, that's been wounded, disappointed, again and again and again. Because the alternative is this hardened heart. That's closed, that separates us from one another. And we begin to create those boxes of othering. Who deserves kindness? Who deserves respect? who deserves care. Can I offer you kindness without knowing your story? I know my friend's story. Okay, I get it. I see why you got there. I don't agree with your actions, but I know you. And I trust that you will make amends, do what it takes. I had this realization many years ago that in this offering of metta to all beings, it's undoubtedly we are offering these well wishes to someone who has caused great harm. Undoubtedly. Even the person, I want to think fondly about the person who grows the food that I eat or that harvests the food that I eat. I don't know how they treat their beloved, how they treat their children. And when I start to try to figure out who goes in the good column and who goes in the bad column, that's a huge movement of energy and time to divide and judge. I honestly believe that, I think Bertrand Russell has a quote, when you are happy, you will do good. I knew I was going to, I never remember it. I don't think I have it. I don't. That we think that when we're, oh, it's the opposite. We think that when we are happy that we will do good, but it's actually that when we are good, when we do good, we will be happy. And, you know, we've heard it many ways. Acting is this, right? Setting something in motion. It's kind of what James is practicing with, right? Like, okay, I get it. These are the phrases. I'm doing it. I'm doing it. I'm doing it. I'm waiting to feel it. I'm waiting to feel it. Right? But it's setting this intention. What are we setting in motion? Setting this intention to care. And it's not this fanciful idea about love that's dependent on this condition or that person or a particular situation. Those all point to the ways that we judge and divide who's lovable, who's not. And our work is to cultivate a heart that loves. Period. Without stopping to judge who's deserving or what we'll get in return, or how we'll be perceived. And a lot of times it is just trying it on. There's always, not always, for a long time early in my practice, it was very difficult to start with self. I kind of put myself in the category of the difficult person. And even as I thought of my benefactor, teacher, I could see all of the ways that I had elevated and defined what made them worthy of love. And the neutral people, there's a lot of them. And I could see even how there were conditions for that group of people, right? If they were friendly, or they made eye contact, or they smiled, or some condition that wasn't known to them that I created. And I know myself when I'm cranky, and particularly with people I know, but when I'm really cranky, even when I'm with people I don't know, I often will avert eye contact. I think I'd be SOL if everyone is holding me by my own standard on any given day. I'd be hard pressed, but here goes my method, because I wasn't making eye contact, or I didn't hold the door. My mother was my difficult person until she died, which was last summer. I had this sort of fantasy that she would turn into a sweet old lady when she was dying. And she didn't. She stayed herself the whole way through. I mean, it kind of makes sense that we are who we are. And my wishes for her to be happy, to be at ease and peaceful, really did become more full, genuine, even though it was very difficult for her. But what opened for me is seeing the suffering, her own suffering, that prevented her from being happy, being at ease. And my own heart became a little more tender toward her. Without expectation that she would change, that she would transform. And that offering transformed me, and thus transformed our relationship. And so I could tolerate a little bit more. I had a little bit more to offer. And so often we meter what we're offering based on not only what we think someone deserves, but what they're going to be able to give us back. And I love that analogy of metta, like the sun, not discerning everything without exception. Gets light. The metro as well, and there is an obvious dramatic increase in gun activity and people dying as a result. And as a Black person, on one hand, I understand the mounting frustration with systemic racism and the impact on our community. And I want people also to have a more skilled response and expression that doesn't cause harm, right? So I can be so unhappy with this is the way it is, right? It is this way. And I can wish well, happiness and ease, right? Because the heart that is open, the person that feels cared for and seen and respected and positively regarded, far less likely to cause harm to another human being. Far less likely. And so if me sitting on my cushion sends that vibe, that energy out into the world, and it's received, I'll keep practicing metta. And I'll keep practicing in person, right? When someone is before me in a conversation, in our relationships, it's not this solitary thing that's separate from our lives. Priming the pump, if you will, right? So we got the script going, and then when difficulty is right here, we're beginning to condition a new default. right? Pause. Someone said that earlier. Let's take pause. And just like that, we're at time, everyone. Thank you so much for joining me on a cool Friday evening for a long weekend. Thanks, Jessica. If you are interested or able in supporting Common Ground Meditation Center, usually Jessica takes care of me this way. You can visit the Common Ground website to make a donation. We will be, I think, trying to move back toward meeting in person in some iteration that will begin over the summer, slowly, yet to be defined. But we have been quite fortunate over the pandemic to actually increase the offerings that we've made, unlike many, many sanghas and programs who, thank you, Jessica, who have had to cut back or even close their doors because of the generosity of folks just like you. We don't have a huge long list of benefactors who are offering large amounts of money. People just like you who offer their time and what they can. That has allowed the center to operate completely on donations. So, within just